Hans Monderman is I read the other day, the world's most famous traffic engineer. And of course, it's a joke. There aren't any famous traffic engineers. Lots of famous people, but no famous traffic engineers. And yet, if you think about it, you know, traffic engineers actually shape the world we experience and enjoy or hate more than anybody else. So it's good if there is at least one famous one. I'm going to ask Ben Hamilton-Bailey, who knows Hans very well, to introduce him. Hans was he started his career as a civil engineer, building roads, I think, and moved into traffic safety, and has been doing some very remarkable things since then. And there aren't many people who bring about a revolution in thinking about highway engineering, about urban design, about making places, and Hans is one of them. I read recently him described as having the appearance of a soccer hooligan. They have very well turned out soccer hooligans in the Netherlands, and the temperament of an engineer. And I'm just very glad that he doesn't have the temperament of a soccer hooligan and the appearance of an engineer, which would be frightening on both counts. So thanks for coming, Hans. It's very good to have you with us. And a lot of people are interested in to hear what you have to say.
Well, maybe for a better understanding about the things I learned, I will start with a little explanation what I did and how I came to these kind of things. Some 30 years ago, we had 3,000 deadly accidents in Holland, and the politicians thought it unacceptable. So the minister was actually forced to take some serious measurements. And one of it was bringing some specialists together, coping with the problems of road safety, and covering all the layers of government. The problem for, I was one of those people, was that actually all the normal local colleagues of mine thought actually, well, that guy is saying we don't do the job well. So it was a very difficult job, and the only way we could keep our heads above the water was actually always trying to give new insights and to organize special quality that wasn't available at local government level or at central government level. And so I started the first 10 years of my profession doing nothing else than doing accident analysis. Just looking at the accident figures and data we got from the police, and the question was quite simple: how come? How is it possible that people have accidents? No one wants an accident, and it still happens. What's behind that accident? And within a few years, the first thing I learned was actually that it had nothing to do with our guidelines. It had nothing to do with cars. The problem is always whenever people are using the car, then accidents happen, but not cars have accidents. And when you look at all the guidelines from that period, it's never about human beings. It's always about cars and the deceleration rate and acceleration rate and the width and the length of a car. Never about possibilities that humans have. So the human factor was actually fully overlooked. And you can still do your driving exam in Holland and you will never meet the word human being. It's about drivers. So it's absolutely a very technical orientated way of looking at things. But when you look at accidents, accidents are always with people involved in it. That's a big new world you can discover. And I think all the things I'm telling you tonight is actually that discovering of the human factors in the traffic system and how we learned to organize a little bit of space to make people more aware of the fact that they're vulnerable and they have to organize their behavior with other people and to make them more careful. Well, this is a little bit introduction. This picture, it's a wonderful picture. It's actually coming from an economical professor, and he uses it in showing, he's saying the story, there's someone coming to me, a friend, and he's saying, I have a wonderful idea. I want to make an ice skating rink in the middle of the city, and I can sell skates and go on. I think I'll get rich. And beginners can enter the first time they wanted to skate, and professionals can exercise all around. And I heard that story, professionals and beginners. I said, well, the first thing is needed, I think, is that these people should need a helmet. On that very hard ice, if you make some certain movement, it could be very, very dangerous. And I think it should be a one-way street. And we should have a concrete separation between the beginners and the people that are profis. So he said, but when I would organize it that way, no one will come. But we know those skating rinks, and we know they function quite well. And what I actually want to show with this picture is that what we have forgotten is the way that people can organize their own behavior and coping with their own problems. And this actually, we know these things, they work quite well. It's not such a big problem. And that's a better way. This picture shows that we don't trust people. In many cases, people could make their own choices, but here you have no possibility. We force people just like some animals in a zoo, I think. You have no possibility to escape to all the things we designed for people. And it's all meant to protect people from risk and to avoid people to meet each other. And what's actually going on is a little story about this picture. When I tell a bit about this picture, this is just close to the world I live. It's a main road from central government. It's 8 meters 20 wide. It's carrying about 8,500 cars daily. The 85 percentile speed is 87 kilometers an hour. There's a bicycle pass of 2 meters 75, and it's carrying 800 bicycles a day, and 20% of it are little motorcycles. We had the last 5 years 25 accidents, from which 3 were little motorcycles, and I could go on for half an hour. And what you now perceive, this is a traffic engineer. This is the way engineers look at this place. But there's another way of looking at that place. It was the main road from central government, from Napoleon times, and it's because there was a little sandy hill alongside. You could, in winter, when the whole country was flooded with water, this was the only way you could enter the capital. So that's why that road is over here. And in the times of Napoleon, we already collected some fees for people who used the road, and that's why that little fee toll house was over there. But already some 100 years ago, we stopped with it, and then the yard warden lived in that, because there was a baronet living a little bit further. It's a wonderful estate over there. And then he could keep track of all the people who wanted to steal all the rabbits and so on. Two absolutely different stories about the same place. The story of the traffic engineer, all figures and isolated, and the story about the soil, the quality of life, the people who lived there, and history. And what's so nice in this picture and this story, actually, all those different functions still have something in common. You can read it in this space. And on Sunday, it's crowded with people who want to visit this place, because it's a nice place to be, because all things are still a little bit in harmony with each other. Yes, please. This is a picture from, what was the name of the guy? Mr. Enard from France, and he already had designed, actually it looks like a roundabout, but it was just meant as designing a space that can organize the behavior of people. Actually a traffic engineer, without any car. He didn't have any car in his mind, there were no cars. But he was already thinking, how can I organize places for people so that people could meet, and organize it in such a way that it could function very well. So already many people were already a long time thinking about these kind of things. This was public space, nothing more than that. Quite simple, many functions in the same space, and many people who are confronted with each other. What shall I do? Take the left side of the road or the right side of the road when there is someone coming? You learn to be what it meant to be a good civilian in a free society. And you could even exchange a cigarette on the street. It was even allowed in those years, not a problem. And even when the car entered our world, it was not such a big problem. It fitted actually quite well in the world of all the other movements in public space. But the next picture, when only the rich people bought a car, it still was not such a big problem, because the hierarchy in the streets was the same hierarchy we had in society. So it fitted actually quite well, and things went quite well in harmony to each other. But the problems came in the next picture, when all people bought cars. Then we had to organize to regulate, and government took over. And the problem is actually, since that moment, it never stopped. We always added things to it, and we always try to force people within the ways of thinking and the way of behavior we wanted him to be part of. Because otherwise we had no instruments. And the next picture, please. Now I try to give you some little building bricks about the things I met in those last 30 years. This is all the accidents in the area I live in. And what you can see is, on the top right corner, there are quite a lot of accidents. How come? And here we have very little accidents. And whatever selection I make, for instance, these are the deadly accidents in the same period. You'll see that still in that area we find a lot of deadly accidents. And if you look for instance, feminine accidents, or bicycle accidents, or children accidents, it's always the same pattern. So the conclusion should be, those accidents have nothing to do with the road or the type of accident. But what does it have to do with, why is it on that area? Well, when you look at the main network, all the main roads stop before the North Sea. And here's a main road, there's a main road going up to here, and here's a main road. On that area we have no main roads at all. So there is a strong relation in the way you build up your network and accidents. And you can maybe work for 100 years, but you will never solve that problem when you don't change your network. It has nothing to do with people that don't want to obey the rules. It has to do with the network. And the next one, well, that's the map. It's this area. You see, here are main roads, there are main roads, and here was a big barrier by the water. And in this area, we find that enormous amount of accidents through 10, 15 years, 20 years long, and we never found a way to cope with it. So the way you build up your network is the first thing needed for road safety. But how do we build up our network? This network is built up by the numbers of cars. The more cars are driving on the road, the bigger the road is. And because it ends up in the North Sea, okay, the road ends. But for those people, it's very, very horrible, because many people lost their lives because they were too little cars to make a main road. So the number of cars, I think, is not such a good indicator for the need of a highway. There must be something else. And the next picture, too. And I try to find out what actually makes me looking for a higher quality road. Well, what we learned with 30 kilometer areas was actually that people accept 2 minutes driving with 30 kilometers. Maybe three, but that's the end of acceptance. But 3 kilometers to that direction or that direction, that's about 3 kilometers to 3 kilometers. That's a very big area for 30 kilometers. And it actually tells you that within 3 minutes you have a road of 50 kilometers available. And that's what we find in Holland, doing all the different pilot schemes with 30 kilometer. All those schemes show the same acceptance. It's about 2 to 3 kilometers an area that people accept driving with lower speeds. But many of our smaller cities fit wonderful in that pattern. That's not a problem. Then after 3 minutes you need a 50 kilometer road for traffic. And then 5 minutes you need a main road. And when you look at the way Holland has been built up, the road network is about with these figures. So now I had a new way of looking at if it's needed to build a highway with these figures. They are multiplied by about 3 when you look at the area where all those accidents were. And actually I've done it several times in Holland when I look at the map and think, well, when I look at the figures, there must be a lot of accidents happening in this area. And it does. It's actually, when you make these figures too big, you find more accidents. So you need to have some relation with the time that people are on the road before they meet the next quality of a road, and not the amount of cars. And that was actually what I was looking for. Yes, please. And this is actually the map that engineers love, straight lines and figures. But what I show in this map are only the roads needed for traffic. The 120 kilometers red ones, the blue ones 100 kilometers in Holland, and in between the 80 kilometer roads with the bicycle path. And here, that grid, those are the 50 kilometer roads, for instance, in Amsterdam. This is the network we need for cars. But what I'm actually saying is that all the other roads are not part of the network for cars. That's public space. And it's this network that is facilitating our society that we can skip the world of human beings. And I often pose the question to an audience and say, have you any idea what's the purpose of the road network? Have you? Why do we have a road network? No idea. It costs such a lot of money. Strange that we have no idea what's the purpose of it. Well, after some time, mostly someone is saying, well, it's meant to go from A to B. I agree. But that's only for a very small part of the network. And when you think a little bit back in time, for about 100, 150 years ago, there was a network of roads, of bridleways, of footpaths, church roads, and so on, that was covering the whole continent. You could walk to China with only one quite simple purpose, facilitating the meeting between people. You could meet other people with an army, or you could do some trading and merchandising with other people, or look for a wife. It was just facilitating the interaction between people. Where's that network gone? You can't walk to China anymore. Within 5 kilometers, you're stuck on the highway. What actually happened is that we took over the whole human network for people by car, without having any knowledge and any notion about the real value of that public space network. And that's actually what this map is showing us. This is the only roads you need for traffic. And how did we organize it? Oh, well, we are very good in it. We made guidelines and laws and details with the guidelines. And what happens now is that my profession is actually, well, protecting itself from all the enemies. You can always say, no, that's not allowed. There's always a guideline that's not allowing, but you want. And that's easy, because when you say no, you don't have to defend yourself. That's easy going. Up till you're going with pension, it's not a problem. You can say no and no forever, and nothing will happen to you. So actually, my profession has locked itself up in all the guidelines and laws. And actually, then learning stops. I can imagine that you think, what a strange picture this man is showing us. But it was shown me first by a Belgian professor, and it was such a wonderful story, that's why I use it often. He said, what do you see? A mostly male audience. No one said a word, of course not. He said, what you see is actually, this is an artist. This is Magritte, a Belgian painter. And what he shows is actually what a man thinks of a woman. Quite simply, this is what a man finds important. But we all know that a woman is much more. And what's happening here, that this painter is actually objectivating a subject. A wife is not an object, it's a subject. Space is not an object, it's a subject. But what we do as engineers with all our figures, it's objectivating subjects. And there's a quite simple word for it, that's rape. Rape of space, rape of the human beings. Because it's not about all those figures, it's about the quality of the subject. And that's actually what this picture is showing is quite wonderful. And this is what happens when you only look at the figures. It's just such a lonely picture, a single driver on the bicycle. And the only knowledge of that there's a shopping center here is paint on the road. That's the only thing that's left. So when you go on only interpreting all those figures, it might be quite useful. I think there were 15,000 cars daily. Well, the car took over, and space is gone, and even the center is gone. And the only way to replace it is with paint on the road. Another little building brick. It's about a little girl, Albertine, with a white collar. And it's about a roman by the French writer Mr. Proust. And he wrote a novel about Albertine, where her fiancé once said to her, I wanted to go next Sunday to my uncle, south of Paris, and then in the afternoon we could visit your niece. But Albertine said, that's impossible. We always went by horse and carriage on Sunday, and we stayed over on Monday, and on Tuesday we came back. No, he said, we go by automobile. She'd never heard about automobiles, but she'd never seen one. She said, well, he's rich, he's well educated. Let's have a look what happens. And indeed, he came by automobile on Sunday morning, and at about 12 o'clock they were at uncle's. But at 2 o'clock, Albertine looked at her watch and said, well, I think when we also want to visit my niece, I think we have to leave now. She said, ah, not being in a hurry, okay. One glass of wine, and they left at 3 o'clock. 6 o'clock they were at Nice, and in the middle of the night, about 10 o'clock, they were back home. But now there's a question, what happened to these people? They never were in a hurry. They had 3 days for visiting uncle. And suddenly they have a car, and they are in a hurry. How come? Well, whenever you see a car, the first thing that you can see in a car is a clock. that's ticking away the time in an objective way, and you can measure time. For instance, it will happen that my son came home and said, oh, I gained a quarter of an hour today. And my question could be, what do you do with it? Feed a chicken or take a cup of coffee? What did you do with that quarter of an hour? Or maybe the next day he lost half an hour. Why did you leave it? We could have a search for it. That's such an idiotic way of looking at time, because you live just a lifelong time on this earth, and that will not change. And that actually, if you look a little bit closer to time, time is not something very linear. Time can have very different values. For instance, when I go to a clothing shop with my wife, for me, time stops. But for my wife, time flies like hell. So the perception of time can be quite different depending on the context you're in. And that's interesting, because many of our professionals are always concerned about the context of the road. Architects, city builders, green. And when we have the knowledge about what context can do for the perception of time, we can influence speed. You can't influence speed directly. Yeah, but physical measures, but that's clutter. But if you have the knowledge that context can be changing speeds by changing the perception of time, then we have a wonderful instrument, because we have the knowledge of building context. So this is a wonderful, nice building brick. And for instance, I always give the example of a train. I've never experienced someone going to the train driver saying, I'm in a hurry, could you speed up today a little bit? It's system time. Quite another way of time again, and so there are so many different perceptions possible of time. This is a picture I've stolen from Professor John Adams, but I use it a little bit different. I say, can you imagine when these people don't even helmet on their head, how they would behave? Well, I think very, very careful. Each branch you hit will hurt, it might even bleed. So you're very careful, but then the helmet is put on your head, you get a wonderful Kevlar suit around you, big boots and ABS on the motorcycle, and within a few days people are speeding with 120 miles an hour over our local roads. That actually all those wonderful things we add to the system always have compensating effects. And maybe that the end result is zero. In many cases it is, or even negative. We never took it in account. We always looked at the advantages of these wonderful measurements. And it's part of my job that I am an engineer and I can make the world safe. That can only be done when you fully neglect the compensating effects. And that has to do with risk. I was called by someone from Microsoft, and it was a director, and he said to me, I'm next week in Europe, I would like to meet you, because we have followed your ideas for more than 2 years, and I would like to discuss the way you do things. I couldn't believe my ears. I said, what do you mean? I'll explain. If you have the possibility to meet, I can explain to you. And what he said to me was quite simple, and I think it's quite a big value, the knowledge behind. He said, what I discuss with my wife, I don't discuss with my children. And what I discuss with my children, I won't discuss with my neighbors. So there are always different circles around me that allow me to open up the information to the other or block it. So I can protect myself to other people. And the fact that I can protect myself can also give me the confidence to make the step towards someone else, because I can always go back in that protected world of me. So what you see, what Jan Gehl's saying about the interaction between public and private space, is actually the same in social way. And those are called liminal circles. And he said, what you are doing in public space is making people aware again of the other one. And you can read in body language or eye contact what type of guy it is. And you can open up your mind for that other people or block it. So those liminal circles work again in your designs. I never thought about it, but I think it's true. And in that way, it's a very thing, again, a little building brick in the way we have to look at designs. Can we organize those circles again between people? Well, this is an example of how it works. It's quite simple. These people have some birthday on the street, and you can go along with your car, but I think you have to congratulate him first with his birthday. Or you don't, but I don't think if you don't, that you use the street another time again. So it's a social interaction that these people owe the street that makes it a little bit more easy. But you see actually how it works. Well, here, the interaction between private and public. private with a little cycle of the child is interfering in the public space, we immediately perceive what's going on, and you won't speed. It's one of the strongest instruments we can use, the interaction between public and private context. How come that we have to invent it newly? Because in the 40s and the 30s, we had no idea about these problems. It was simple public space. Well, it started actually in the city of Redburn in America, where they built a city fully separated in functions. Houses fully orientated inside, cars outside, and little islands where people could live. A city for cars. And that idea with that grid is still dominating the way we plan our cities. And later on, the Buchanan report from England saying actually people and traffic should be separated. And these cities can be found anywhere in the world, and they look the same wherever you are. It looked like anonymous places, because it's always the same idea, making functions separated, separate people from traffic. And that's actually the heart of my profession. This is some safety campaign out of the 60s. A normal poor people would say this is war. One false move and you're dead. This can't be true, because this was public space. That network has a skin up to China. Where is it gone? Or this one. Roads are for cars and lorries, not for pedestrians. How quickly things are changed at the moment that we got cars. That suddenly there was no notion anymore about the fact that it was public space for all of us. The most important space we have in our society. It's simply gone. And we didn't even have any notion about the fact that it was gone. In Holland, this was a horse and carriage in the past, and it's changed now. It has become not a farmer anymore, he's become a driver. A driver of a towed wagon, following the rules for towed wagons in Holland, red on the back and white in front. Is a brake deceleration rate of 2.5 square meters per second. And maybe at first sight you think this is a group of musicians. It isn't. It's a civilian platoon in Holland following the rules for towed wagons. Again, red on the back and white in front by darkness. But there is no brake deceleration rate. There has been deep thinking, I think, from my colleagues in The Hague. And mostly there should be a leader assigned. Mostly it's the one in front of it. How we change the human world in a regulated world. Question to you, is it allowed entering by car? What do you think? Is it so difficult? Well, let me rephrase the question. Do you think it's decent entering by car? It isn't, huh? I actually try to show you with this picture that we have two absolutely different systems with two absolutely different answers in the same situation. And that's actually what already Ben showed you, the two different types of behavior, social behavior and traffic behavior. And this is another one. What speed is allowed? Is it so difficult? Oh, well, I explain. It's 30 kilometers an hour. It's a 30 kilometer area. But do you think that 30 is appropriate when children are going just to school? No. And in the middle of the night, when no one's on the street, is it appropriate? Well, I think 45 is also possible. What we do with all those rules that we apply to situations and people, if they don't fit to the situation that people are in, you take away the ethical judgment in the mind of people. It only is a rule. And the only thing that's left for us is opportunism. So be careful with all those rules, because 30 kilometers will never fit in the situation you're driving over here. One moment it's 28, then it's 24, then it's 15, and maybe 5. And maybe the next moment it's 40 again. And we treat people like idiots, as if they couldn't judge it properly by themselves. And if they don't obey, we put the police behind them. And in my opinion, it's quite simple. We know that people, the body of people, can have an impact up to about 30 kilometers an hour. Then you destroy people. I don't want to destroy people. I live with people. It's part of my life, living with other people. So 30 kilometers is an appropriate speed. And where do you need to drive that speed? Where people are living. No, well, where are people living? Where houses are. What more do you need to know? Why do we have to explain on signs that you have to drive slowly? People are not idiots. But if you treat them like idiots with all those signs, you'll see that they behave like idiots. They drive 30 kilometers when the school is entering. Be careful with all the rules. That's actually what I'm saying. And take people serious in the possibilities they have in coping with their own problems. And as an example, I was asked at a school in my neighborhood, and they said, well, could you come and help us? We have a problem with a chaotic way of behavior at a school entrance. And I entered over there. And the moment I came there, I thought, well, I've been here before. And I looked a bit more closely, said, well, this is the third time I'm here. And I looked again, said, well, I can't imagine what the problem is. So I entered the school, and all the parents were sitting over there with some teachers, and I listened for about a quarter of an hour. They explained the problems. Speeding, chaotic parking, children having to cross the street between parked cars, and so on and so on. And after I had heard all those complaints, I said, well, what I perceive from what you're telling me, you're saying you have a problem. I don't think you have a problem. I think you are a problem. We changed it three times, but you refuse to change your behavior. I don't care. I'm not responsible for your behavior. And how do you think I could solve your problem if you refuse to change your behavior? And from that moment on, I changed my attitude toward many of the problems I faced. We took over many of the responsibilities from people. And as long as we take over, people won't take their responsibility. From the moment you say, it's not my problem, and I hope I will never see you again about traffic problems, it stops. And they suddenly realize it's our problem. We have to solve it. And why can't they solve it when they have 12 teachers on that school and they know each other from the children? How come they ask me? I have no idea. Just a shift in responsibilities. Make me responsible for their problem. And I think in very, very many cases, that's what's going on. And it only will stop as soon as you say, well, I think you are the problem. Driving along the coastside in spring, and you see suddenly a sign, please drive carefully, storks. We have only 8 of those wild animals left in Holland. So that's very rare. So I wanted to see that animal, and I had luck. A little bit further along the road, there it was. And when you look a little bit more closely, there's a boy being born called Tom. It's written on the wing. And when you look at the road, I think that Tom has been born yesterday. Father started working again and put all the mud on the road with his tractor. And now you could discuss with my colleagues, for instance, I think a sign is needed. Mud on the road. I think that's wisdom. When it's raining, it's quite dangerous. But why not warn for the fact that the doctor is coming at 12? The midwife is coming at 9 o'clock in the morning, and the whole family will come at 20:00 in the evening. And maybe that the neighbors will come at about 5 o'clock when all the milking has been done. Why only one with a cow would become some risk, and not when society is endangered? How foolish are we with all the signs? Because you know almost anything about that family. When the wash is also outside, you know how many children they have, where they live, and you can see that father started working, the boy has been born yesterday. What more do you need to know to behave in the right way? And what I want to show you with this picture, that as traffic engineers, we fully neglected the context. With all our signs. We made the road an anonymous place. Yes, and then you have to explain all the things. This is actually the picture that's showing. Traffic, that's my profession. The grey area. And the green area, I had no idea about. But it's exactly the green area that's the context for traffic. Where the most biggest changes in behavior come from. So it should be part of my profession. And then at the end of the 60s, actually we started a war against cars, and this is called the crossing lampposts. It was quite creative in those years, but it looks horrible. It is horrible. Our people didn't accept all those clutter on the street, and we hired some artists who said, well, you have to bring some rhythm in it, then the acceptance will be much higher, and we did. I don't know if the acceptance was higher, but it still is ugly. And we made things with one of them so complicated that we had to design new signs for people how to get out. And then in that period, my superior said to me, whenever you go along the way you're doing it with all those clutter on the streets, we'll stop you. And I left my job just crossing the countryside with my car and meeting people and being the expert. So I thought, well, okay. And within a few weeks, it was this village asking me for some help because they have problems with speeding, some 1,500 children going to school on bike. But all the normal instruments were taken away from me. So when you're young, you can't say, I don't know. So I said, maybe you should build something more village-like. I had no idea what I meant with it, but, well, it was just an answer. But after a few months, I was asked, what did you mean with it? I said, well, just as an escape, don't you have a city planner? A consultant, yeah, they had one. And someone from Green, yeah, I said, also a consultant. Well, if we could cooperate, all three of us, to make a design, I think we could build something village-like, and we did. And it looked like this. And after some months, I wanted to measure the speed. I needed a lot of courage because I thought, nothing, no flower pots, nothing in the street. This can't work. This won't work at all. But it was so strange. I took my radar gun and wanted to measure the speed. I couldn't. That the overall speed over the old trajectory was lower than 30 kilometers an hour. That the radar gun didn't accept even those low figures. I had never perceived such a drop in speed before. Because when you add all those clutter to the street, it's about 10% reduction all over the old trajectory. And suddenly we made a simple street look a little bit like a village, and speed drops more than half. It turned my whole world upside down. It was the first time I experienced that things were different, and it took me some 15 years in understanding what happened, and even, I think you know it immediately, it's that simple. If you want people to behave as in a church, you have to build a church and not a disco. And what we did, we built discos. And of course people behave differently, that there is a very, very strong relation between the way you design spaces and the behavior of people. We never took it in account as engineers. We just built it the way we thought we had to organize things. And this is a few years later. It's now 25 years ago, and now it changed again, badly. And why? Well, our new bred engineers don't have this knowledge. And they didn't know anything about the story before. So they simply changed it for maintenance reasons, and it looks again horrible now. So if we don't bring this knowledge into the heads of our new engineers, it will never stop. I could end up to my dad in doing these kind of things without any change. And it's not so difficult. We all know when you drive with your car on the camping site that you drive very carefully. You're part of the context. And maybe the people you're meeting now are your neighbors within 2 minutes. You don't know. So it's the context that is so strongly influencing our behavior. So if you have a problem with a camping site along the road, it's an 80-kilometer road with a camping site with more than 20,000 people in summer. We simply put a tent in the middle of the road and made a little square around it. And in summer, it's crowded with bicycles and people meeting each other. Sometimes a caravan is waiting for some entrance. It's a very social place now. And we haven't had any accident since we changed it for 10 years ago. It's that simple. Some example from Italy. And actually, in many places of the world, without we know from each other, these designs are there, sometimes maybe 100 years. It's not something new. It's just from the traffic point of view, it's new. That we can accept that people can organize their own space, their own behavior in space. And, well, these are many of the examples all over Europe that show how that works. And this is quite extreme. You know, it's quite close to here at Seven Dials. Even such a handicapped lady is part of the whole system without any problem. Why? Why should it be a problem? It's so recognizable. And keep it simple. There's a church. And what's the road telling you? Well, there's a church. What's more to be told? When it's complicated, it will never work well. Again, this picture. And I normally say to people, when you see these two different ways of behavior, any normal person would say this is war. We fully organize the war in our public spaces. How come? And how come we accepted it? And the only way to get out is making choices, because those two worlds are continuously interfering with each other. And only by making choices, is it part of the human network or is it part of the 20% traffic network? And the road in between is the most endangering road you could build. This is the road in between, fully organized from the point of traffic. But okay, you're still pedestrians, and how to cope with that problem? The only thing is you can rely on the traffic lights. But I don't know if you can rely on, when we look at the accidents, you can't rely on traffic lights. That we rely on things, when you really look a bit closer, that are very dangerous, but we still accept it. And in Holland, and in, I think there are many places also here in London, you could even have a cup of coffee and a piece of cake with a traffic sign between your knees. How both systems continuously interfere with each other. And this is one of the most valuable places from the point of heritage. This is the entrance of the city of Groningen, where the water system in the past entered the North Sea. And that house was called the Arsenal, and it was guarded with a very big cannon. That was quite readable. You could understand why it's there. And then the traffic engineers came, and I don't understand it anymore. I have no idea what they're telling me. It's just from the point of view of traffic, not from heritage. And some of my colleagues are starting warning for trees. I think they have a need for work, because there are so many trees.
And the hanging benches.
And if you neglect the quality of space, this is what happens. It's a wonderful place. It's a wonderful entrance of the city. But yeah, we neglect it fully. And then we have to explain all the things to people. Or we think people are dummies. You have to explain what a sign means. Or this one. Showing so wonderfully that we have two systems mingled together. And this is a cartoon that they got from Ben, and I think the wonderful sign, give up, not give away, but give up. Whenever there's a problem, we add things to the system, and we never look back. It's not important if it works, because people were complaining, and then we add something to the system. And the next time people are complaining, again, we add something. And never these kind of things are being taken away. And this is actually a cartoon that's also showing a little bit what Seven Dials means, or the Leweyplein in Drachten. We can organize spaces where people can organize their own behavior. And the effects are quite positive. We don't have severe accidents anymore. We don't have queues. And there's a very efficient, organic flow of traffic with very little conflicts. And people are getting more social. The liminal cycles are working again. There was a black spot. They introduced simply a little bit flat, made it flat, and they introduced terraces with seats along the street. But when you drive along those seats, you drive carefully. Well, that was the only thing that was needed. And no accidents more anymore. And there was an experience I had. This is a ferry. And when a ferry is coming, entering the land, and suddenly 400 cars pop out of that ferry, mingling with all the passengers in one simple square. And any normal people would say, this is absolutely chaos. And when you're back home after holiday 3 weeks later, you remember that my holiday started. That was top quality. I smelled the sea, I could hear the seagulls. It was a wonderful moment. That chaos and quality can have something in common. It's not something that is always to be avoided. Well, I think it's, you all know Seven Dials. How actually the social system fully takes the place for their purposes, even though there are cars. And no one cares about the fact if they go left or right around. It's that simple. And this is quite a simple village with 4,000 cars in Holland, but what I try to show is actually that this is human space, without any doubt. But also this is typical Dutch. That people are the same. Our DNA is the same all over the world. But we have different cultures. So you can never copy the solutions we make. What you can copy are the ideas, what I try to give you from my experience in your brain. And from those ideas, you can make your own designs, fitting in your culture. And they will absolutely be different. They should be different. And that's actually what I try to show with this picture. And on the other hand, what type of behavior is wanted? It's that simple. You don't have to ask that question. The use of architecture. In the past, the road went left along the houses. And just to make traffic slow down, we changed it and brought the road back to the center of the church. That you perceive again the church as heart of the village. And you could say in the past there were two villages, the left village and the right village. And now we have one village again. And just simply by the use of architecture, that we need the knowledge of an architect, just as well as the city planner. Here were traffic lights. And actually when you look at the place, it's a bit of square. So as a consultant, I said, well, why don't you take away the traffic lights? Well, next year they were also being renewed. They said, well, we could try to do it. And they changed it, took away the traffic lights. And it's more than 12 years ago now. And since that moment, we didn't have any severe accident. And the traffic flow is fluent. We don't have queues anymore. And on your bike, you can go and cross the street. You don't have to stop anymore, as you did in the past. So actually, it's very positive. The only thing that some people are still complaining about is saying, well, it's not so clear what to do. What we did is we added a little bit of risk to the perception of people. And it's that little bit of risk that is making people more taking care for each other. That's why we don't have severe accidents. That's why the speed drops. And that's something that has to be explained to our politicians, that you can't avoid risk. You have to manage risk. And that's always part of these type of designs. Multifunctionality. Of course, public space has multifunctions. And so gradually, when you know how it works, I was able to do it in more and more busy environment. This was a main road with 12,000 cars, and the side road has about 5,500. So altogether 17,500 cars on this intersection. You had traffic lights. And what we did was simply removed all the things related to traffic. And we made it just a simple flat square. And then see what happens. Oh well, people find their own way. And it looks a bit like some choreography. People turning around, turning behind each other and signaling with their hands and shouting and simple, normal human behavior. And we don't have queues and we don't have had really severe accidents. Small accidents happen, yes, of course. And that's also what the last few years are saying to people about accidents. We have so many accidents, but in my opinion, some 20%, 10% of all those accidents are disasters. They are destroying the lives of people because someone is killed or injured. I would do anything to avoid those accidents. But all those 80% of other accidents, 80, 90%, those are very positive experiences to keep away the other 15%. Because, for instance, the first accident my son had with the car of his mother, I would have paid for it. It was an experience he will never forget. And after that moment, he will drive more carefully. So that we have to learn that accidents will always be part of the system. But it's unacceptable that people lose their life in the traffic system. I think I wouldn't have such a system. And that's what we have to fight against. And this is one of the solutions. A school has problems. And what to do with the school? What you see mostly in Holland when there's a school problem, we isolate the school from the road. But the problem is, whenever a child is coming out of the school and crossing the street, and you have isolated the school from the street, all the users of the street have no awareness of the fact that there's a school. And then you have a very dangerous situation. I know three places where in such a situation there was a deadly accident. But many people think we need big fences, avoiding the conflict between children and the road. You can't. And the problem is to convince people that all that isolation is not the best way to do it. And here we are explaining with a lot of people what we try to achieve. And this is how it's done. They wanted absolutely, that's also part of a law in Holland, you need a fence around the school. That we try to make the fence part of the school idea. That is readable when you go along. And it's not something that is isolating the school. No, it's bringing the school into the world of the car drivers. Quite a different way of design. But it took a lot of convincing those people. The city of Haren, it was a main road from central government from some 150 years ago. And there were bicycle lanes alongside. And the shopkeeper said, it's horrible. We don't sell anything anymore. People all go to the big city of Groningen. It's so uncomfortable. There is no public space anymore. So couldn't it be changed? And I became part of the working group. And we wanted to change it. But you can already see, if you want to have more space for public space, you can't have those bicycle paths anymore. And that was an enormous discussion in that society. It took about 2-3 years, with people fighting for that bicycle path. Especially those bicycles with those very nice helmets and so on for the long distance. And this is how we changed it. And what we now see is a little drop in the amount of traffic. We have no serious accidents anymore. And the shopkeepers are very content with what happened. People are coming back again to that area, using it as a shopping center. And that's good for my health. And in that road, we made two different squares, one at the city hall and one at the church entrance. Just a simple flat square where the road ends at the entrance of the square and begins at the other side of the square. That you're suddenly aware of the fact that you're part of the context around you, the church or the city hall. And there's a little group of people still saying, we want our bicycle path back. And I think the only way to cope with that problem is it will die out when you wait long enough. Because they will never change their opinion. But when you look at the figures and we see what has happened, it's very positive. And it's now an example that's used in Germany quite a lot. Well, this is a picture actually about a human factor. When you see at the level of 30 kilometers, you see that the accidents raise at a certain level. And on top, on the main road system, it goes down again. So if we discuss road safety, that's not over there, it's not over there, it's a road in between. So whenever we build the road network, never, never build a road in between. And when you have them, remove them, change them, make a clear decision. It's traffic, okay, then go upwards. And if it's not, bring it back to the human scale. And of course, we need a road in between. There is no world being built, it's possible, without that road. But make it as short as possible. Keep the population as less as possible. Because it are the most dangerous roads where you can't solve the problems. So making very clear decisions in the way you organize your network with your politicians is the first step for shared space. And this is the human factor why. An example just simply from Tokyo, that actually in many places of the world now these kind of designs pop up. Denmark, I just got a wonderful example from Switzerland. Already also they worked for more than 25 years in the same way. And we didn't know it from each other. Spain. But I'm not so keen on examples, because each example is fitting in the culture of the country it's made. I'm much more in favor about a way of thinking, that you can make your own designs in your own country, in your way, fitting in your culture. So that's why I'm speeding up a little bit. Each country also has its own materials. But the same people. In our DNA. But culturally different. You would never see this in Holland. This was the way it was organized on Kensington High Street before. The war. And this is how it looks now. Such a change. And it's so simple. It's not that you fully repave the street or something like that. Or very little small differences. Well, because I learned more and more to cope with these kinds of design, I got more and more confidence how it worked. And there was a very big main intersection in the city of Drachten. I was asked, could you help us? Because we wanted to be a nice place. But there were 22,000 cars, and we expect even to become more in the future. It's actually the central entrance for all the cars and the parking places. But on the other hand, there's a theater. And there's a main line for bicycles, too. And a lot of pedestrians are crossing the street to some parking places. So actually, it's a very strong human place. But it's also a very strong place for all the cars entering the city. How to cope with that problem? And after some 7 years, at least, 7 years of designing, this was actually a design we made. I had the idea I can never cope with that amount of traffic without a roundabout. That will never work. But I don't want to build a roundabout. I hate roundabouts in city planning, in architecture. It's something horrible in all the straight lines, and suddenly you have a circle in the middle. So I said to the designers, I want a roundabout being built that's not there. It's not part of the design. Could you do it? And well, they popped up with the design. It still is there, but okay, yes, please. This is now how it looks like. The road is almost fully flat. There is no high difference at the curb anymore. And I didn't know what would happen. I had no idea. But already from the first day when it was opened, the cars were very, very careful. And slowly. And after a few weeks, they went a little bit faster, but suddenly all the bicyclists tried to show with their hands what he wanted to do. And after about half a year, there was a very organic flow of traffic. And I'll show you a moving picture of how things go now. We do have it now for more than 4.5 years. We haven't had any severe accident yet, but we had with traffic lights. And we don't have queues anymore. We had big queues in the past. And the pedestrians mostly had to wait for traffic lights. We have made some pictures over the full day long. There was never a bicycle that have stopped. People negotiate their way all over. And because they use their own brain, it's always much more effective than one brain of a civil servant. All those brains of people cooperating together, making it actually a very organic place. And what I find, when I see how it's happening now, maybe the most important aspect is that people take care for each other again. They are orientated on each other. And they meet each other, often in confrontation. They have to solve their own problems. And what I hear from the politicians, they say, well, what we find in the discussion with peoples all over the city is that many people recognize now that it's not always government who has to take care for them. On many other sides, many other fields of society. Well, this is a new built roundabout, and I just wanted to make some pictures, but there is still a roundabout hardly there, and it's also a nice square. But what's so nice is actually that already the owner of that pub is penetrating public space with his chairs. He's already claiming it. And that's what I like. That's what it's all about, that we recognize again the value of public space and what it can mean for people, and that actually people recognize it immediately for themselves. We don't have to explain it on science. They know how to use that space. Oh, well, it's a nice cartoon I got from Ben. There's some guy who was suddenly painting some paint on the wonderful city hall. And the next picture is showing that people are so annoyed by what's going on, they call the police. And the next picture shows that the police is coming, of course, immediately. This is not allowed. This is so horrible. So that should be removed immediately. And the next picture shows the guy working and trying to put it all away again, that, well, he had to do it. But on the same moment, some guy from local government is coming, putting all the paint on the road. And next picture. And then we think this is wisdom. That we lost our sight for quality of public space. That's actually what this picture is showing. I think it's the last one.